Why are we here? I think that's the big question. Why are we having this discussion on a gentleman's agreement when it comes to resupplying our own ship? How did we get here, sir?
Well, the gentleman's agreement is only valid between the two gentlemen who agreed to it. It cannot bind us because it was not publicly announced. Because under the doctrine of unilateral declaration, it must be announced. No? So it cannot bind the succeeding presidents. It's only binding on the two gentlemen. That's one. Second, the reason why Duterte agreed verbally and privately to that is because he said it will cause tension with China if we repair the BRP Sierra Madre. So sabi niya, I agreed, where this is now per Harry Roque, because the narrative of Harry Roque was called false by Sal Panelo.
Harry Panelo, oh.
Yes, but assuming that that was correct, what Harry Roque said, well, it's disadvantageous to us, because if we allow only food and water to be brought to BRP Sierra Madre, then BRP Sierra Madre will collapse because the superstructure of Sierra Madre is already rusting, and the Navy has estimated it will just collapse anytime unless it is repaired. Mm-mm. So, in other words, you enter into the agreement knowing that the ship will collapse and our presence will end. And then you are giving actually a Ayungin Shoal to China. Why will we agree to that? That's one. Second, when Duterte agreed to that, there was already a ruling of July 12, 2016. And the ruling says specifically, Ayungin Shoal is part of the EEZ of the Philippines, Exclusive Economic Zone. And that means under UNCLOS, it's only the Philippines that has the exclusive right to put up a structure there. Mm-mm. To manage and conserve the natural resources. Because if we are not present there, the Chinese fishermen will go there and destroy, pulverize the coral reefs to get the giant clams embedded under the coral, which is what they did in Skoda Shoal and in Russell Reef. So we have to be there to prevent the destruction of the marine environment. So, but if you say that we will not repair BRP Sierra Madre, that means you are conceding that it will soon collapse and we lose our presence. Now, my suggestion, because you know we brought this issue before the arbitral tribunal, that China is harassing our resupply to BRP Sierra Madre, and the tribunal should order the China to stop the harassment. The tribunal said that activity is a military matter. When you resupply BRP Sierra Madre, that's a military activity, and that is outside the jurisdiction of UNCLOS. So we lost on that issue. Although it's however, that's why I've been recommending that we change our presence from military to non-military. How? We put up a lighthouse there to be manned by the Coast Guard. We put up a marine
disaster center. You mean where BRP Sierra Madre is? Is that what you're saying? Put up
the
lighthouse?
We will have to look for a place.
Okay.
Which is proper. We'll have to look up for a proper place within that shoal. It may be there beside Sierra Madre. I couldn't tell now. So we put up a lighthouse that's civilian in character to be manned by the Coast Guard, which is civilian. We put up a marine research center, which is to be manned by the UP Marine Science Institute, because we have the right to preserve the marine environment, to conserve and preserve the marine environment, and to ensure that the resources there are exploited sustainably. So we have a right to be there. That's allowed under UNCLOS. And we will put a Coast Guard station there, where we will have one or two Coast Guard vessels as big as the resupply ships, because you cannot get a big ship to enter that shoal. So what is the meaning of that? Once there is a Coast Guard vessel there, any attack on that Coast Guard vessel is an armed attack. The U.S. has repeatedly said that any armed attack in the South China Sea against a public vessel of the Philippines, including a Coast Guard vessel, will trigger the operation. They have been emphatic on that, including a Coast Guard vessel. So we are still protected there's still deterrence, even if we put there only a Coast Guard vessel. There's a small one, one or two, which can navigate in that shoal, because you cannot bring a heavy ship there, a big ship. So that has been my suggestion.
All right. Let's talk about some points that you just mentioned right now. Number one is it clear under UNCLOS that even if Ayungin Shoal is within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines, there should be no military presence in Ayungin Shoal? Is that black and white in UNCLOS?
No, it doesn't say. It merely says that any military activity is outside the jurisdiction of the tribunal. In fact, it's not illegal.
Is it still the choice of the Philippines?
Yes, it's not illegal. It just says if you do that, we cannot rule on any issue that may arise from that because it's a military activity. But it does not prohibit the Philippines from putting a military structure there.
Mm. Okay, number two. That particular suggestion was actually the same recommendation made by Attorney Harry Roque yesterday. But Senator Antonio Trillanes says it's a trap. He claims it's exactly what China wants. The reason that BRP Sierra Madre, even if in its degraded state, is not being attacked or harassed per se, is the fact it can trigger the Mutual Defense Treaty. Are you saying, sir, that even if it's a Coast Guard vessel in Ayungin Shoal, it is still covered by the Mutual Defense Treaty, that China will still not have provocative action in that area? Because according to Trillanes, that's the only thing stopping China, is that's a commissioned ship and it's Marines manning that ship.
Well, the U.S. has repeatedly, again and again, said that any armed attack on a Philippine public vessel in the South China Sea will trigger the operation of the Mutual Defense Treaty. And they said, including the Coast Guard of the Philippines, a Coast Guard vessel. They have repeatedly said that.
Yes, but the problem is China isn't doing armed attacks. They're doing gray attacks.
Okay, that's a different matter. Because to trigger the operation of the MDT, Mutual Defense Treaty, there must be an armed attack. That's why China knows this. It does not, subject our Coast Guard to an armed attack, because they know that that will trigger the operation. And they're very careful about that. They're not attacking Sierra Madre, although it's totally defenseless, because it will be armed attack on a public vessel. But they know that the Coast Guard is covered. That's why they're not attacking. Now, they're using gray zone tactics, water cannon. Water cannon is still a gray zone. There is no, even the U.S. said it's not. It will not trigger the operation of the MDT, except that one U.S. admiral testified in the U.S. Congress that, but if Philippine Coast Guard personnel dies because of a water cannon, then that will trigger the operation. But that's only that officer saying. But what is clear is that it has to be an armed attack, and my thinking about that, it is a lethal weapon that is being used, because if you've seen the footages of a water cannon battle between the Vietnamese and the Chinese, between the Japanese and the Chinese, none of them invoke any. The article in the UN that in case of an armed attack, they can retaliate. So that's still a gray zone, unless we come to an agreement with the U.S. That these gray zones are considered armed attack, use of water cannon, then China will
and
have
the
to
laser
change this.
Lights. Yeah. Yes, and laser or any dangerous maneuver.
Yes. So that, as of now, that's a gray zone.
Okay. All right. Now, Attorney Harry Roque said that with a hardline stance of this administration, if this administration continues its hardline stance with China on the West Philippine Sea, he claims that we may lose Ayungin Shoal. And in fact, you heard it. He said, mark this. I said it on your program. If the Philippines keeps doing the same thing, China won't give in. We risk it. and will be forced to remove our soldiers there out of starvation. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that's laughable, Karen. First of all, the strategy of China is to intimidate us. They know that if they use armed force, if they fire a single shot, we can invoke the treaty. So they use intimidation. And if you allow yourself to be intimidated, you lose. China is saying we have this huge air and naval base in the Spratlys. We have the largest naval fleet in the world. We have the largest submarine force in the world. So you have no choice but to accept the 9-10 dash line as the national boundary of China. Mm. Now, if you are intimidated, then you lose. Mm. Now, look at Malaysia and Indonesia. They refuse to be intimidated. They send their survey ship to their EEZ, drill ship to the EEZ, to survey and drill. China said, you cannot do that. There will be war because that's within the 10 dash line. But Malaysia still did it. They sent its survey and drill ship together with its Navy. And at the same time, the US and Australian warships were conducting naval drills. China couldn't do anything. The same thing happened with Indonesia. They sent their survey ship accompanied by their Navy. And at the same time, the US aircraft carrier Ronald Reagan passed by in the same area. So the Chinese will intimidate you. But if you stand fast, you refuse to be intimidated, then they cannot do anything. Now, that was, you know, the moment you intimidate the Filipino that China will starve you to death. You are the spokesperson of China, because that is precisely the strategy of China. The strategy of China under their three warfare strategy is they will win the South China Sea without firing a single shot.
Okay.
And that's why they use this intimidation. So any Filipino who echoes or parrots the Chinese line is an agent of China.
Mm-hmm. And where do you think is this narrative coming from? I mean, there have been talks that there is a campaign going on, essentially coming from China, that you do have different sources introducing or recommending this particular narrative. And Attorney Harry Roque yesterday was actually he was actually suggesting one particular: soften, make things work, diplomacy, status quo. It was those words that were commonly used.
Yeah, that's precisely what Duterte did. He pleased Xi Jinping. I simply love President Xi Jinping. There will be a massacre if we defend our maritime zones. Mm-hmm. And that's why nothing happened. That's why our position is getting weaker, in the sense that we need really to get the gas in Reed Bank. The primary purpose here is to get the gas in Reed Bank. Because even if China doesn't recognize our economic zone, as long as we get the gas, then we win. That's why, in my book, Malaysia and Indonesia are winning. China doesn't recognize their EEZ, but they're still getting the oil and gas, and they're winning, because this is a battle for natural resources.
I wanted to ask you, what is Malaysia doing that the Philippines could be doing? Like, for example, how is Malaysia exploring their oil and gas? Are they using a third party? Are they contracting a third party? Or did they get into a state-to-state partnership?
They're doing it on their own, because Malaysia has a large petroleum industry. They send their own ship, but this ship, you can commission it. These ships are available for chartering by third. Anybody can charter this. Like, for example, Forum Energy doesn't have its own ship, but it can easily charter a ship to go there to survey and drill. These are services by third parties. You don't need to possess the technology, because you can rent the technology here. So that's why Forum Energy, which is the service contract over Reed Bank, is prepared to send its survey and drill ship there if they have the protection. They said, we need the protection of the Philippine government. And so the plan is we should send the survey ship accompanied by our Navy. At the same time, they will be a joint patrol with the U.S., or other allies, because that's exactly what Malaysia and Indonesia did.
Okay. And actually, it's quite interesting, because the president, President Marcos Jr., has been invoking, reiterating, pushing, announcing the arbitral victory award. And of course, the Philippines has gotten more allies worldwide because of that and sympathy. But yet the biggest action to take would really not to dialogue with China and just start drilling. Kasi ang sinasabi ng ilan is a dialogue is still important. Should we still get into a dialogue with China when it comes to drilling in the reed bank?
Well, we should keep on talking because you don't lose anything. But do like the Malaysians, what the Malaysians and Indonesian did. Send your service ship. Don't delay.
On your own. Yeah.
Yeah, on your own. Because that is their EEZ. They don't need the permission of China. Because Duterte has put into our mindset that we need the permission of China to go there, to reed bank. We don't need the permission of China. And Malaysia has proven that. Indonesia has proven that. So we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Just send our survey ship and drill ship together with a joint patrol with the U.S. and its allies.
Actually, that's quite true. When you hear interviews that say China wants this or China won't give in, China won't, it's actually moving on to the fact that you'd have to discuss or compromise with China somehow.
Yes, China has no veto power over our sovereign rights. It's up to us when and where to get the gas in the West Philippine Sea as long as it is within our EEZ. But Duterte has always put into the mindset of Filipino people that there will be war. We need to get the permission of China. That's crazy because that is not in the law. That is not in UNCLOS. It is called exclusive economic zone because it is the coastal state that has exclusive right.
Okay. Ang tanong ko, this is more psychological and cultural, ha? Itong tanong na to, sir. Because I've interviewed you, I mean, so many times on this topic. Bakit tayo ganito? Ang Pilipinas ang may victory. Tayo ang may arbitral ruling sa UNCLOS. And yet, you have Malaysia, Vietnam, other countries. They are fighting for their EEZ. They are drilling and surveying on their own. They don't have these discussions on what China thinks. Why are we here, sir?
Because that was inculcated to the public by Duterte. When he became president, he said, it will be a massacre. We don't have a chance. Sabi niya, do not patrol the EEZ, only the territorial sea. Sinabi niya yun. And sabi niya, I already allowed China to fish in our EEZ. Lahat ng violation ng constitution, ginawa niya na. But since he controlled Congress and the Senate, nothing happened. That is why that kind of thinking has seeped into the consciousness of the Filipino. We have to reverse that. We have to think like the Malaysians and the Indonesians.
And the Vietnamese.
And the Vietnamese.
Okay, but let's balance the conversation. No? So, Attorney Harry Roque said, former President Duterte did what he did simply because in 2012, and I wanted to ask you this, when the late President Aquino went full frontal on China, right, sent a Navy ship to Scarborough. And I remember the late Albert Del Rosario said that there was an intervention on Scarborough and there was an agreement, a gentleman's agreement of some sort that, was it brokered by the U.S., that that both ships should withdraw from Scarborough?
Yes, it was brokered by the U.S. Assistant Secretary Kurt Campbell.
Yes, so that was 2012. So the Philippines sent its one Navy ship and there were, I believe, 30 ships coming from China. And the U.S. brokered it that both should withdraw. The Philippines withdrew and China did not withdraw. So ang nangyari is Duterte kept saying, that we lost Scarborough Shoal to China under Aquino's term, under his time. And Attorney Harry Roque is saying that if we keep doing this, Ayungin will end up the same as Scarborough Shoal. Parang in effect, hindi naman natin kaya to panindigan. Ganun ang punto. Aatras din tayo, parang ganun.
Well, pag ganyan, umatras na tayo hanggang sa territorial sea natin. Because if you follow that line of argument, then China will get everything. But why is Malaysia and Indonesia being successful in getting the gas in their EEZ? Because they have a consistent, coherent policy.
Yeah.
Now, in the case of Scarborough Shoal, there was the U.S. brokered through the Assistant Secretary Campbell of the State Department, brokered a mutual withdrawal.
Yeah.
And we both agreed. Mm-hmm. And then China reneged. So there, right, you know right there that you cannot trust China. That's why we cannot trust China on a Ayungin Shoal. That's why that we have to learn that lesson. Remember when China first occupied Miss Jufri, China said it is just a fisherman's shelter. You can take advantage. But what is Miss Jufri now? It's the largest air and naval base of China in the South China Sea. The Chinese call it their Pearl Harbor in the South China Sea. And that has been the narrative, the factual, what actually happened over the last 50 years. China keep on saying, in Fiery Cross Reef, China occupied it in 1988 and said, we are just putting a weather radar station to help UNESCO in its global oceanic survey. But what is Fiery Cross Reef now? It's an air and naval base, a huge air and naval base of China. So that is the narrative of China to lull us into believing that its intentions are peaceful, but they're actually invading us. So we should not listen to China. We should look at the facts, look at history, look at the what they have actually done in Mischief Reef, Fiery Cross Reef, Subi Reef, and what they actually did in Scarborough Shoal. So actually I'm saying we should bring this issue of territorial dispute to the International Court of Justice, challenge China. If you say that you owned it since 2,000 years ago, prove it before the International Court of Justice, because they don't have any document. The first document that China came out claiming the Spratlys was in 1947, very late in the game.
Yeah. Mm-mm. Okay, so but then taking it to the International Court of Justice, that's a whole other discussion, right? And just for the viewers, that would be a whole different entity from your first suggestion of the UN General Assembly. Yeah. Do you remember?
Yes, because the UN General Assembly is to get world opinion on our side. But to get a definite ruling, it has to be an international tribunal. And the proper body for this is the International Court of Justice, because this is now the territorial dispute. The maritime dispute goes to an UNCLOS tribunal. That's a different dispute.
All right. Now let's talk about Ayungin Shoal, rehabilitating, repairing Ayungin Shoal. Now, there is in the budget, I remember, it was put in to improve the facilities in Kalayaan. I can't remember the exact amount, but I know that it was put in the budget. And perhaps there's also a budget for repair in Ayungin Shoal. Now, Attorney Harry Roque had said at one point, dapat ibahin daw ang diskarte. Kasi we are doing microphone diplomacy. Lahat ina-announce. He says he believes during Duterte's time, inayos din yun, pero tahimik siguro yung pagkaayos. Although he didn't have information. So is this the right way to go? I mean, right now there's transparency and we invite the media over, right? To witness what's happening in the West Philippine Sea. And Harry Roque says he doesn't know if that helps because he said diplomacy shouldn't be under the freedom of information, everything about it. There should be talks that are going in behind the scenes as well. Does this benefit us, Justice?
Well, if you follow the Duterte formula, you keep quiet, you make deals, then the more we will be in trouble. Because Duterte did not disclose to us that they had a gentleman's agreement. If that is the kind of diplomacy that Harry Roque wants, then we are in big trouble because you keep on conceding your ground. So what is important is we bring the issue, if ever we can, whenever the opportunity arises, to a tribunal, ICJ or UNCLOS, because that any decision there is permanent. Like, for example, the arbitral award of 2016. No matter what they say, more and more countries are supporting and acknowledging the arbitral award. And China is getting isolated. So we must get more and more of these arbitral awards. Like, for example, in the destruction of the marine environment in Skoda Shoal and Russell Reef.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Do you believe
if
that
we follow the formula of Roque, the more we will be buried, the more we will lose ground, because that is exactly what Duterte did.
Okay, just quickly on that, bringing it to the ICJ and also the marine, filing for marine damages, can that be done effectively by civilians? Or do part of the effectivity, yes, like with UNCLOS, was government initiated?
Yeah. It has to be done by the state, because the states are only the parties to these treaties, the UN Charter and the which included the creation of the ICJ. UNCLOS, only state parties are allowed there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Now, speaking of the gentleman's agreement, Senator Aimee Marcos said that there was a bit of exaggeration. The exact quote is, "Exag, their reactions are OA, overacting. This is not the first time having an agreement. If there is an agreement, the former president's talk with China about BRP Sierra Madre was more on practicality. The agreement was only practical to let the needs of the Filipinos there be brought food." So she was actually reacting to your reaction, no, about the gentleman's agreement. So what were your thoughts about Senator Aimee Marcos's?
Well, you have to be very careful when you do in your relationships with China, especially in the dispute. The moment you agree to send only food and water, then you waive your right to repair the ship. And you have exclusive right, because we have the exclusive right to put up a structure there. And Sierra Madre is an outpost. It's a structure that we beach there. So the moment you agree to something, then you are bound by that. You are waiving your right already. And that's why China is saying, oh, you already agreed. You're bound by that. But that is contrary to the arbitral award. The arbitral award said that's part of the EEZ. And under UNCLOS, if it's your EEZ, you have the exclusive right to put up a structure there.
Yeah. You know, Justice, I wanted to ask, as a last, to close, is, do you believe the West Philippine issue is now being politicized? I mean, there's the Duterte recommendation, his strategy, and there was the Aquino, and now there's the Marcos Jr. strategy. But at the end of the day, countries like Malaysia, Vietnam, other countries, it's quite clear what their strategy is in their own EEZ. Parang sa atin, it's kung ano yung gusto nung nakaupo.
Well, that's because we are a vibrant democracy. We have freedom of expression. But sometimes it goes to the extreme where you are infiltrated now by China. We have a lot of Filipinos who have become the spokesperson of China. And the number one guy who became the spokesperson of China is Duterte himself. Because the strategy of China is to intimidate its neighbors into submission. And Duterte intimidated us on behalf of China by saying there will be a massacre. We cannot go to war. We cannot go beyond our territorial sea. That means give up already your EEZ if you don't patrol your territorial sea. Because the Constitution says we must protect our marine wealth in our EEZ. So it was very unfortunate that Duterte himself became the defender of China, the spokesperson of China in all of these things. So it's, we have to choose our leaders carefully.
All right. Last words. I guess what's interesting is this is all about the foreign policy of President Marcos Jr. Where would you want to see him go forward in terms of acting on the issues at hand?
Well, first of all, I'm happy that he has decided to say that we have to protect every inch of our territory and we have to assert our maritime rights in the West Philippine Sea. And we must use the arbitral award to do this. Now, the most important thing, really, the acid test is whether we can get the gas in Reed Bank, because it's very critical we get the gas. So I think it is going there already. And I hope that soon we will send our survey ship and drill ship accompanied by the Navy together with a joint patrol with the U.S. and its allies, because that is really the formula to get the gas.
On that note, former Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio, thank you, sir, for your insights this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you to our viewers.